So I'm ready to start again. So I hope everybody have a small break. Sorry, I was probably, I thought to have the break in a short while, but I was a little bit long. So I'm trying not to run, but I try to show all the information I still have to show. So let's now go back to the use of high resolution or high spatial resolution data to look at the products or to look in details what happens in the area of activity on the volcanoes. So first of all, I was saying that in our system, we took into account mainly ASTER, Landsat 8, Sentinel 2 and Sentinel 3 to increase the number of observations by using a co-registration module. And this, of course, needs to have also DTM, atmospheric correction, because again, the output is the surface temperature or to map the hotspots. That means where you have high temperatures on the ground. So a quick overview of the sensors, ASTER, that has different area of the acquired information, different spectral areas, and has five band in the tier, and the VNIR has three channels, and the SWIR that not working anymore was having six band, so we cannot use the SWIR at the moment. Data, tier data are very good because also have 12 bits of dynamic range. That means that they are pretty radiometrically precise. And the 90 meter of resolution makes the ASTER the one that has the highest resolution for thermal infrared. The only problem with ASTER that is a little old. It was launched in 1999, but it never worked like Landsat in acquiring data all the time, but is on demand. So it doesn't not cover everywhere in the world. But on volcanoes, it acquires mainly everywhere. Instead, Landsat is a long missions starting in the 70s. And so with Landsat, you really have the opportunity to analyze in the past and not only in the present, the data. And has two channels in the thermal infrared, one at 10, between 10 and 11, and the others between 11 and 12. Those data permit to measure the surface temperature pretty well. And then of course have visible and near infrared and shortwave infrared. So the characteristics the in detail, the bands of Landsat, the 30 meters is the resolution for Landsat 8. Here also I compare it with Hyperion, but Hyperion is not functioning anymore. So it's at the moment we have Prisma that gives the epispectral data. For the Copernicus that somebody was asking for information, here you can see in the table, both from Sentinel 1 to Sentinel 3, the information about the different sensors. So for Sentinel 2, the MSI instrument has channels in the SWIR and as in the visible, in the near infrared and in the SWIR. And as the resolution between 10 and 60 meters, 60 meters is used for the channels that could give information for the atmospheric corrections. And while the Sentinel-3 has both midwave infrared and thermal infrared at 1 kilometer resolution. So let's see what kind of algorithms we are using for ASTER and for Landsat. For Landsat, we used in our procedure the emissivity separation, the temperature and emissivity separation algorithms originally developed by Gillespie, TESS algorithm, that is the one more stable. Of course, there have been a lot of improvement to this algorithm in the past. And instead, for Landsat 8, since it has only two channels, procedure, we decide that for us was fitting well the Barsi equation. And so this is the one that we use in our procedures. The surface temperatures in this case needs to get the emissivity from outside. It's no way to measure the emissivity directly as we can do with ASTER. And so we have this, what you see in the bottom here, this possible source of information from ground emissivity. The very good one is the map made by ASTER, is the JED map that is available also from the site, from a USGS site where you find the ASTER data. And also there is the emissivity product, the disaster 5 called, that you can use as input for the emissivity. Or you, of course, you can make your own ground measurements. And in this case, you use the two channels to retrieve the temperatures on the ground, and of course you have to calculate through a radiative transfer model the upwelling, downwelling, and transmittance for the atmospheric corrections. We use the test algorithms, as we said, it was developed by Gillespie, and for us there is been very tested for a long, long time, for this 20 years now. And so we use it and we extract the emissivity directly from the ASTER data. Although the test algorithms, as the way as it function, is starting with the maximum emissivity, and then he calculates, he separates temperature emissivity. But since the Etna has a very homogeneous surface, it's basalt that has 0.98 mainly of emissivity, it represents a good target for this for a good homogeneous area for this calculation. As we said, we use the Motron for atmospheric correction, and we used a lot of nighttime passes because they are less contaminated by the contribute of the temperature due to the heating by the solar radiation. We need, though, to make measurements on the ground. And to make validation, so we use the micro FTR instruments, and so we went to measure real emissivity on the Etna and Campi Flegrei. So those are some results. And what is important that before using this algorithm, we had to make them validations to understand if our procedure were correct before using in a operational way. So we made also comparison between the algorithm performance with the JED emissivity maps, the ASTER 5, the retrieval algorithms, the measured emissivity on the ground. And so we then make, as you see in these plots, some comparison with the algorithm, with the procedures that we propose in our system. And what we also did, we had contemporaneous passages of the satellite, in this case Aster, and we had contemporaneously measurements of temperatures on the ground. For this test, we had a very good agreements between the ground and the survey and the satellite retrievals. So we were pretty confident that at least in this case for Solfatara, for Campi Flegrei, our procedures was giving good results. And the same we did again with Landsat and other passages, and we also have acceptable results. Of course, the atmospheric corrections are critical, and also you have other factors that they may influence the comparison of the data. But you have to use them using temporal series. Looking, those are only for calibrations. I will show at the end how we use in the monitoring techniques, so in the modern system using time series. For Etna, we had campaigns made. This is a long time ago. It's more difficult. Of course, you have to go up 3,000 meters and set up the measurements. So we need, for Etna, as other volcanoes, validations are not so easy, but in time to time, I think they are needed. Once the techniques is very solid, consolidated, I think you can proceed with more confidence.
Fabrizia, there was a question on this point, basically asking, what can you safely do with thermal data if you don't have any field data available for one reason or another? It's too dangerous to get out there or something.
Just to go back here, I think the best is to make a cross comparison. So more data, so you can use Aster, Landsat, but even Sentinel-3 or MODIS data to compare if their measurements are in a pretty good agreement, since you can find contemporaneously passages, especially if you use a low resolution with the high resolution data, you have the opportunity to co-calibrate. In this case, even Landsat and Aster were passing at the same time. So there is the chance to do it with different sensors without being on the ground. So I would suggest to do that.
Great, especially thank you very much.
Especially for high altitude. So that's another campaign with cross comparison, as you say. On Etna, at 3,000 meters, we do mostly that. And there were good agreement between Aster and Landsat data, but even also with Sentinel-3. So once we had this procedure in place, we adopted these methods to produce products inside the ESA geohazard platform, exploitation platform, that has different products also from SAR. And this again is a free, I think you can sign up to this platform and retrieve the data, the products that are available. So I think it's another important tool for people that wants to test this kind of products, especially in this case was made for volcano applications. We had two algorithms. One was measuring the surface temperature using both the TESS and the BARSI algorithm. and the other was taking into account different sensor, Aster, Landsat, and Sentinel-3, and the other was another algorithm to detect hotspots using shortwave infrared with Sentinel-2. So those are available inside this platform, and those are the list of volcanoes that were chosen to be monitored with this kind or used to produce these products. The good thing is that all the data are co-registered. So if you go in one of those, you may find Landsat, Aster, and Sentinel-3 or co-registered. So you maybe don't have the same resolution, but they are well registered, so can be used to look at the variation of temperatures.
A few questions. One was asking, for these areas where you've got co-registered imagery from Aster and Landsat and other satellites, what kinds of differences in land surface temperature values do you typically get? It's within a degree or so, or?
Yeah, we are around the degree of difference. Of course, time to time, we need to do, co-calibration or intercalibration analysis. Of course, we have this constant activity on Solfatara Island, Solfatara Crater, because it's easy to access and we have the thermal camera on all the time. So that's our calibration site. The other is Mount Etna, but of course it could be interesting if other people wants to participate to use the data and see if the data are a good, could be validated by their campaigns or if they have sensors in the area. Of course, volcanoes are difficult, are not the best place to go, but there are some of those have good equipment on, so can be used, especially like we talk about Hawaii. Of course, it's after Etna, I think it has a lots of measurements in place.
Very good. I'm sorry, there was another question. Yes. Is it possible to tell from land surface temperature when was the last time a volcano erupted?
Well, of course, you can use both the temperature maps especially the emissivity maps could be used. Here, there are not not a product that this kind of platform gives because it's an intermediate product, I would say to see the old or the previous lava flows in this case or products, you need to classify the surface and the different lava flows that are visible. Though they have different characteristics, especially if some time passed they are older, like because you have lichens or other weathering, that happens on the surface. So this is the way to detect. But you can use the temperatures can be give information if you have still cooling of lava flows, then maybe you can see the past that's already cold and the one that are cooling. So you can combine, but I would say that the emissivity is the best product for detect different lava flows.
Okay, very good. And there was a question about asking about the processing steps included or involved in creating the Aster 08 product. I don't know if you could speak to that at all. Or
the Aster, I don't understand what kind of product, temperature, emissivity, or?
Yeah, I'm not sure either, but it's asking about the processing steps included in the Aster 08 product.
Well, the Aster, we use the radiance values, the one that are produced by that you can find in the USGS database, and once you have the sensor radiance, we put in our system that has also the DTM and the emissivity that could be directly calculated by Aster or use the JED products, and so you have to apply the test algorithms and calculate the atmospheric variables by in our case we use Motran, and those give you the upwelling and downwelling component. Once you have all this information, then you apply the test algorithm on the Planck function, and you retrieve temperature, surface temperature, and surface emissivity. But maybe I can send more information offline on that.
You're good.
So these are the volcanoes of this platform that are inside this platform. So going in the platform itself, you can see where you can find eventually the products of surface temperature. So that's some view how you can see inside the website of this ESA platform. And in the case of Etna, you see all the acquisition, then you can use one of these icons on the right, and they will calculate or having already in the archives the surface temperature for different sensors. So in this case, give you all the information on the acquisition and so on. You see the Etna there, and in details, in this case, there was also an activity, so the temperature detects the general temperature of all the area, so you can use not only for the volcano, and then you see the temperatures of the lava flows. In this case, was an eruption detected by the Aster. Instead, if you want to use the hotspots, then of course there is the other algorithm that just detect where the say the lava flows happens. So this is the address, and I don't know if I'm going back. It was similar to the others. What I want to show is that you can see, as I was saying, the different data in different acquired by different sensors, and those are contained in the JEP system co-registered, so you can use them in those are temperature maps, and they are compared between different sensors. In this case, you can see that you have one on the 26th of March, one on the 27th, and one on the 1st of April. So you can have information on ongoing eruption in this case. So this is our results for what regard the use of Aster and Landsat-A especially, so having about 90 meter and 100 meter if resolution, and so our scope in this case it's both for prevention, so to understand using the time series how the temperature on the ground the variation of the temperature on the ground, and in case of eruption it can detect, as you see, the position in details of the lava flows. Of course, those data then could be used with much more information can be retrieved, and that is done in the observatory that I will show in a few slides. The hotspot, just to go on this, use the SWIR data, and these SWIR data of Sentinel-2 and Landsat. So we had some tested on that, like the Kilauea eruption 2008. And what was interesting that we can use a lot of different data, so increase the acquisition time. And so we had 37 data sets. So that's the number of acquisitions that we could use together. So finally, those are the observation available that you can combine in a system that are able to take different sensors and retrieve co-registered images. So we need we had a pretty big amount between Sentinel-2 and Landsat-8. So those are how the images are put together, are covering the area on Hawaii.
Great. There's a few questions. And so one is asking about which software or tool you recommend for processing these satellite images. Looks like I've seen some Envy icons and such, and also asking about the usage of SNAP. Do you find that useful for processing various temperature data?
Well, we use, as you said, Envy procedures in IDL, and we develop the algorithm by ourselves. But I think that also SNAPs or others are nowadays are pretty well, so for Landsat or even for Aster, the algorithms are being validated along all these many years. So I would say if you don't want to develop all the procedures as I show with the, you know, the Motran and the LANS and the DTM and so on, you can use those data and those algorithms that are already included in this software available package. Maybe Envy has a cost, so it's better maybe to use the one that is free of cost. But that's also why we were developing with ESA those platform that where we put the algorithms inside. Actually, you can retrieve the data, but you can also run the algorithm by yourself. But you don't have to buy anything. Okay. It's made in the system itself.
Great.
So I think that it's worth to try or to contact the ESA-JEP system and try to also apply for a user. There is, I think they are testing. So no, they know this. I don't think there is a cost for any use of this data. So for Kilauea, we were lucky because we had this good overlay of Landsat 8 and Sentinel. And Sentinel 2 has two satellites. So we use both.
Okay.
So that's what happens. Now we start to measure different area where you see the thermal activities. That doesn't mean that this is the area of detail area of the lava flow. This is the area where the system detects the temperature variation of high temperature variation. So we made other studies also in collaboration looking at the USGS and the observatory results to see where this kind of information match what was precisely detected by airplane or ground measurements. But still, if you don't have anything on the ground, this can give you information on the area, the general area, where you have the temperatures, high temperatures presence. So. And that's is. I don't say it's automatic, but the algorithms works is independently, so it can be very fast. So the questions, I don't know if there are others, otherwise yep. I will go to
there's the last a, there's a couple of additional questions at this point. One is asking for any, if you could discuss any applications of any hyperspectral applications for volcano studies. And then, so that was one, and there's another question about clouds, but maybe the hyperspectral one first.
Well, I will, as I will say, for high temperatures, we use hyperspectral data for two reasons. Of course, for the what we saw for the general behavior of temperatures at different surface. If you have high temperatures, 1,000 Kelvin or over 500 Kelvin, you can see them well using a SWIR. Since the hyperspectral has many, many channels in between VNIR and SWIR, you can reconstruct pretty well the temperatures of the pixel. Actually, if you have 30 meters or less, you can also use those data for sub-pixel analysis. I don't have here the slides on this part. I may add them before sending. I was just worried of the time. But of course, we use them a lot to calculate the fusion rates, both the mid-wave infrared, the short-wave infrared, and to make the analysis of the thermal structures of lava flows. Because hyperspectral data, if they of course, you have to look at not saturated pixels. They can be really effective to analyze the thermal structures of lava flows. So I that's one. And the other application that also I didn't show here because the timing is for detect gas components of the plumes. Of course, especially you can retrieve water vapor in the plumes that are needed for many, and so to understanding the general composition of volcanic plume, but so there is studies for CO2 retrieval using the two micron channels, and of course for the optical thickness of the gassing plume, not only the, I don't talk of the eruption plumes because you need a frequency that hyperspectral, temporal frequency that hyperspectral do not have. But you can make an interesting analysis of volcanic aerosols in the gassing plumes. So a large spectrum of application for the hyperspectral data. I didn't add them here because I didn't have, I think, much time, and also the algorithms are more complicated. But I can, if there is anyone that needs more information, I can send materials. So we have not only papers, but we have other presentations on the all specific that I can share. So no problem. And we are, of course, I'm available for any other questions.
Great, thank you very much. Yeah, I know there's quite a lot of interest from this group about hyperspectral data and applications. There was a question regarding, I'll just read it. So how are clouds different from volcanic ash in thermal images? I think they look almost similar in visible bands. And then a follow-up question, do you usually want to get rid of clouds, or can you obtain some insight about the volcano situation with the help of clouds?
Well, there is two points that are important. In eruption clouds, the separation between the eruption clouds and the clouds is a very important point for the study of ash clouds, because they mainly happen, and then there is in between clouds if the sky is not clear at the moment. So there were the fact that ash clouds contain ash have a different behavior respect to the clouds that are mainly composed by water droplets or ice droplets. They behave differently wavelengths. So one of the techniques that's called the BTD that was developed years ago, and there are many, you know, Fred Prata and others, very nice algorithms that define good, methodologies to separate the ash clouds by the normal meteorological clouds. What is very important now to retrieve the columnar content of ash or SO2 or CO2, you need in volcanic plumes, you need to measure the water vapor content, because affects the measurements very much. Water absorbs the thermal radiation, so you make mistakes in terms of calculation the columnar content. So nowadays all the algorithms take into account the water vapor elements or effects in order to better retrieve ash content, SO2 content, and even more CO2 content, because the absorption of this gas is very near this other absorption, and also interfere with the ash particles. So I would say we don't need the clouds. If are not volcanic clouds, we are not looking into them. But the volcano emits a lot of water vapor, so are clouds, and we have to know how much water vapor is there. So that's an important point.
Okay, great. And just from the Kilauea 2018 eruption, when it reached the shore and then the lava, you know, hit the ocean, it, you know, produced a whole lot of water vapor and essentially its own sort of little climate system. And we had a lot of rain from that. It's very interesting. And it's just sort of an observation.
Of course, you can, going back to this one, you know, where you see, in fact, the lava the lava was affecting the surface or on the shore. So it looks like, in effect, you have an increase of shoreline because of the lava. But of course, using the multispectral, hyperspectral data can give you a lot of additional information of effects of climate effects of these kinds of large eruptions on the environment, because then you can see how, of course, affect the vegetation and how the, how you see, you can have a microclimate that can be seen also if you are using time series of data, this change that happens during this period. So I think a lot of information, if we take advantage of this quantity of data available.
Okay. So there was an additional question asking about can emissivity of a surface ever be greater than one?
Well, for the theory, no, you cannot. The theory that relates, you know, the behavior of surface in terms of these parameters, the emissivity is cannot be. If you find value more than one, it may be a problem on the calculation, but what I can add, emissivity in some wavelengths change with the temperatures. And that's something that many colleagues are studying around the world. You have to have in laboratory experiments. Not that happens in all the, it's not visible in all channels. Like we made many tests on SWIR to see if the reflectance and emissivity was changing, not so much in that range, but in other people, as many, there are many articles looking at what is the behavior of the emissivity with the temperature. Since you change the structure of the material, that could affect. But emissivity in general, as in the equations that we use, cannot be more than one.
Okay. And I, for those of you who are interested in getting some kind of a credit for attending the session, and just for your feedback in general, I've posted a Google Forms link in the chat. So if you're interested in filling that out, hopefully it is taking responses. If it's not, please let me know. And there was a question basically asking about what are the more, what are the cutting edge sort of scientific questions associated with volcanic eruptions and thermal remote sensing?
Maybe, I don't know if I get the question. I still have some slides.
Oh, okay, show. Certainly. But I guess the question is asking about, are there more, what are the, using thermal data, the sort of big scientific questions being asked right now in volcanology associated with thermal data?
Well, I think that if I can get it correctly, of course, thermal infrared or thermal monitoring or data are supporting a lot of the questions that are volcanological questions, especially on understanding first the observation of how the thermal phenomena change or the evolution of them, that is not easy to follow and is not easy to model without data. And since the volcanoes are not easy to access, these data are very valuable for to answer scientific questions. And I'm sure of that. The fact that, that this observation, as we're just saying, can cover really a lot of different area, say from temperature of the surface, understanding the structure of the temperatures or like lava flows that are not even, and also to understand how they cool up, and that's make information for the modeling of the coolings of lava flows to understand how they can be, they develop or for risks, if they can reach like a populated area or not. You need all this information. So that's, I think it's very valuable. And for, but the very challenging are ash and gas measurements by these instruments in details, because you have a lot of variables and not, it's not easy, but you know, there is a lot of improvements in the techniques, in the algorithms and so. And finally, all the data since are so many, I think can be really exploited in a very useful, fruitful ways in the future, because we have to also to look at what we had already in the past. So more we have missions, satellite missions that are say recurrent, like the Sentinel, like the Landsat, like the MODIS, of course, and more the community can get advantage in analysis, reanalysis, and understanding of the phenomena. I think that's my comments.
Great, thank you.
So I try to be quick because I see time passing, but I would like to show some, very operational use of the data that I was getting from my colleagues from the observatory. So I'm trying to be a little fast, then I will share the presentation. But this is pretty interesting on Campi Flegrei. It's coming from what I show, so it's a result mainly. So we started to have a real use. We produce a bulletin for civil protection, but also we try to use them in the way the vulcanology needs the data. So just again, that's our monitoring system on Campi Flegrei. We have all many instruments, but especially I would like to show that we have measuring of gas, but also we have all these cameras. And this is our solfatara that you see in the pictures, and we use all this camera to compare the result with the satellite data. So again, those are the system, and we had the observation that shows how the uplift, as I say, is very dangerous area, because we had all this increasing of the formation in the last starting from 2013 especially. So we expect an eruption, and we don't know when. So that's where we focus, the solfatara. So we had this camera here that shows the covers only some parts and are where the fumarole fields are. So when you use the satellite instead, see all the area. So we have to, first of all, combine the two geometries that are very different. So we made the geometry of the camera on the ground. We project them at the same geometry of the satellites. And so in this case, we were able to compare what the measurements made by the camera and the satellites, if the two measurements could be comparable. And so we made all these procedures for solfatara. So that's the workflow. And the TIRnet is the system of cameras. And then we have to reproject, as I said. We use a 30 by 30 meters cell, so enlarging the aster or the Landsat that was a 90-100 meters. And we made statistical analysis of the results. So that's the area again. And here you see the satellite acquisition, Aster and Landsat. See, it's a 190 meters. Solfatara is a small point that you see. That's the full frame. And then you see the pixels that are in geometrically co-register with the view of the camera that you see in the black box are the cameras and that the pixels. So then we compare the data that were acquired not only in one or two images, but in a time series of different years. So that's another case of another acquisition. But that's what we get. On the left, there is the camera and the satellite data. The camera is the red and the satellite is the green. So there is a very good agreement between the analysis of the two data sets. So you see, it goes from 2014 to 2018, and we use nighttime passages because they are more stable, since Landsat and Aster were providing those passages. And then you see, of course, that there is a seasonal effects, that are all these, peak the variation that has a very constant plots. So we had to remove the seasonal effects, and we use specific techniques that were able to separate this statistical approach, and then. We get the residuals, and that you see on the right. So those are the temperatures that were seen in the camera and in the satellite. We had to separate that in these two as a, on the left, on the we have Aster and Landsat. So they are a little different because they do not pass at the same day. So the difference are not due to a difference in temperatures, but the difference in temperatures are due to the fact that it's not the same day. But the time series is the same. The trend looks very similar. So there are very, once you remove the seasonal effect, you don't see many changes, but also small changes in the trend of this give you information on the variation of temperature of this, say, fumarole area on the solfatare. So then we made a more statistical analysis of this residual, this residual, you're looking at the images, not only at the trend in the time. And that was made on the medium temperature values, both for Aster and Landsat 8. And you can see interesting information, and Solfatara is very well finely depicted in the yellow-red area. But we also went to others also and try to find clusters of different temperatures using a statistical approach too, like in this case where we made the threshold due to the enlarging the sigma around the media, the mean value, sorry. And so you can see different information on the temperatures on the surface. So this is a study that is ongoing. So, and we had some publication on that, that can, this kind of time series analysis are really rich of information. Of course, we have to separate all the effects, but that's the value of satellite data. I skip now the question, so I finish with that, and then if we have still some minutes already, because on Etna there is a lot of use of the satellite and procedures that we showed before. First of all, of course, we have a lot of instruments, again, the monitoring room and so on. But what is the colleagues there are doing is, again, use all the approach that I show in a very operational way to collect the hotspot detection. Similarly, I show the radiant flux, the fusion rate, the digital elevation model and active lava area. So they are using operational what I show, and they are getting a lot of information and data and help in their, say, work for the monitoring of the volcano. So very quickly, I show that at the observatory, this is for Sentinel-3 data, they are using the same procedures and they are able to detect thermal anomalies. Okay, and in this case, they made a test with echo stress to understand the radiant flux variations, and plenty of information for their observatory. So, we have to develop in time these capabilities, but the data nowadays are really available, and also some products are already available. So here I see again the algorithms that they use to also remove the clouds and understand where the location of lava flows going from different resolution data. So these are customized for Etna. What I showed before could be generally applied. So what I would like to give you as an information that you can use general products that can be found in system, USGS, say the JEP, the ESA platform, but then you can use those to customize your needs, because it doesn't need to do all the algorithms by yourself. And so, but it's very important for volcanologists, because here you can see that from this data, you can understand the phase of the activities, and so when there is like the increasing at the beginning of the radiative, the sharp, and then there is the ash emissions, so that's also show another behavior, and then the cooling and the decreasing. So all these effects are visible on the images, and can integrate and complete the ground data. And if you don't have ground data, you can really have a lot from that. And those are made by the volcanologists of the observatories. So they are, I am a remote sensing scientist, so more using algorithms and data of any kinds. Those are the volcanologists that are really use the products of this study. So again, here they can use the comparison between the Seviri and the thermal camera. You see here that they can be compared, although very different in resolution. So that's a good information that you may get from a geostationary system. Again, on the classification on the lava flows, that also can give information on different cooling stages. And so analyzing, as I say before, where you have cooled lava, and also can understand the area covered by the lava itself, so all the calculations that are needed to know the volumes of the lava. And of course, now I don't have here because of the timing, but the data itself are used to retrieve new DTM and calculate the lava volumes. So now I think I arrived to the end. Last things to say. Etna is a very good laboratory for anyone. And the INGV Observatory at Mount Etna has these big activities that is offer the access of the laboratories and Etna itself to the international volcanological community. So they have this European funding that is on the S3 roadmap, that is the roadmap for the European scientific infrastructures. And through the system, the one infrastructure is EPOS, that Yanzhou is the leader, and regards earthquake, volcanoes, and geology. And so they decide to, there is some, say, grants to do measurements on Mount Etna by proposing a short proposal. And so we have many in the past. Here, this is EMBRI Plus, is one of these systems, that this platform that allowed the people coming from Europe or all around the world to do measurements on Etna. That was made by using UAVs with Costa Rica. And then all these activity now are inside this Eurovolk. There is another activities ongoing that's from the GFC, I think that on Pizzi Deneri from Germany colleagues. What is important, my colleague Giuseppe Puglisi, so that I'm a little bit quick now, can give all the information on who is interested to participate to this program. So I think that I arrived to the end. But any questions, if there are still, I'm sorry, there is a little bit late, but I'm here. So if there is anyone that wants to make any questions, I'm available.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you so much. That was wonderful, and some really good opportunities there at the end. And in particular, just personally, the draping and the comparison of the ground-based thermal cameras with the satellite data, that was really wonderful. I really enjoyed that. It looks like there are a couple of questions. I have reposted the survey for this session, session 3. There's a link there, so please fill that out if you can. But there's a specific question about Landsat 8 here. Mm-hmm. Which algorithm is better for obtaining temperature from Landsat 8, single channel or split window?
Well, we use the Barsi algorithm that is using the split window channel. It can be also used the single channel. The Landsat, the problem with the Landsat 8, but I think will be solved in Landsat 9, that one of the two channels was not really well calibrated. So I think that finally we use a single channel, but both techniques are working well with Landsat. I'm sure that in the new generation, the Landsat 9 will launch, I think, like next year. They will fix the problem of the one of the two thermal channels. That's my suggestion. But in any case, it's better to test because also depends on if your surface is homogeneous, if you are using night or daytime data. We find out that, of course, nighttime is much more stable, and detect better the small temperature variation. But of course, daytime can be used too. In our analysis, we prefer the nighttime. Okay. Because lava are black, you know, and became very hot with the sun. So they don't reveal very well the thermal variation. And then there is any different, any say changes in the wind, but the contact between the atmosphere, the air and the surface has effect in the retrieval, because homogeneous, say there is variations that could be lateral or very quick, and that's have an effect on the retrieval. So unfortunately, is not. Although the question are there, then in the real time, in the real world, the things that behave. It's not easy to model them, but no, more data we have, and better we do.
Very good. There was one other question I saw, and you're getting all sorts of, you know, thank you for your wonderful presentation. But one other question I saw was asking about the ability to detect empty lava tubes from thermal data. Is that something that can be done?
Well, lava tubes can be detected if if they are cold. Of course, you cannot see them if there is a surface of lava flow that is already covering, you don't detect them. But if there is activity under the crust as a lava tube that are still cooling, you might see them. You need high resolution data though, because usually the dimensions are not too big. I remember many years ago that I was talking of airborne data. There was a very large lava flows on Etna, and it was incredible to see not only what was happening the surface, but also what's was going on underneath, because the radiation was arriving to the surface of the lava tubes. So I would say that there is a chance to see them if they are not completely covered by any cold. You even see with the thermal images pipelines with the water that is in the nighttime under the asphalt, because there is not enough signal to arrive to the surface, you can see them. But you need a very high resolution data in thermal data. I cannot do it with 100 meters, maybe for lava flow, for lava tubes, but over 100 meters, you don't easily do CNC things if they are not, the dimension is not proper.
Okay, great. And again, we're a bit over time. But Fabrizio, there are still a few more questions. I don't know if you're willing to take one or two more questions.
Yeah, for me, son, it's okay.
Okay, and then I'll have to close this meeting in the next 5 minutes or so to get ready for the next one. So one question here, is it possible to detect the magnetic anomaly associated with the current generated by lava fluid flow?
Well, magnetic current, I would say, I don't know. The best things is to send this question to one of my colleagues of the observatory, because that are in the slide, the Ciro del Negro. He was also working in magnetic measurements. So if there is made some test or some analysis, my colleagues for sure will know. I don't ever have this kind of comparison, but I don't exclude that you can do some interaction, and so they can be in some way, at least you can, I don't think you can measure probably, but you can see if they have a correlation, like looking at the two data sets, and then you may understand if you measure, you can detect some information. But I would say to send the question to my colleague Ciro.
Okay, very good. And then it looks like one last question I see here, asking about airborne thermal data. Are there these types of data sets available, and are they available for access?
There are several data sets. We don't have many because we don't have many airborne sensor, thermal sensor in Italy, maybe only few. But around the world, there are many available sensors. The biggest data set, the database available, is the NASA MASTER. That is really valuable. Is you can ask the data to NASA Ames. You can look at the master instruments on the web, and you can see that once they were available on Jet Propulsion Laboratory, now is at NASA Ames, and they have flown in many, especially in the United States, but not only, also in other parts of the world. And the other data set available may be given by ESA, that made many campaigns, both of it hyperspectral and thermal. So we made a thermal mission last year in Europe, and I think the ESA will release the data. It's worth to ask, because those data sets are usually taken in repositories. So, but I will start with master data if you are interested to see. Master as visible, near infrared, midwave infrared, and thermal infrared data all together, because as the channels of ASTER and MODIS. So you have a lots of information there. We use them a lot for our testing algorithms.
Great. I don't see any other questions at this time. For those of you who will be joining us for session 4, the last session of the online summer school, that'll be starting in just about 40 minutes. But thank you so much, Fabrizio, a wonderful presentation. And if you'd be willing to share your slides with me, yes. I can then send that out to all the participants.
Of course, I will prepare the slides and maybe adding some information that were requested by the audience, and send it to you, maybe using, we can talk together by mail with best way to share, because it's a big file. But I would like to thank you everybody for the very, very nice questions, interesting in the presentation and in the thermal infrared data. And of course, I'm also available. I will see, maybe review your questions with Ryan and answer any question that maybe you want to give me by mail. So thank you very much to everybody again. It was a pleasure.
Oh, again, thank you so much. And again, Rob Wright from University of Hawaii at Manoa will start in 40 minutes. And that'll be a new Zoom link, which you should have received from me. And again, that'll start in about 40 minutes. And again, thank you so much, Fabrizia. And everybody get up, get something to eat, and then we'll reconvene in about 40 minutes. Okay.
Okay. Aloha. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.